Hey, what's up, everybody? It is Dante Fortson here with another great Bible study for you guys. Today we're going to be talking about Esau and the Horites, or either I'm going to name this the Dukes of Edom. I'm not sure yet. But either way, we're going to be touching on Esau. We're going to be touching on the children of Esau, who he had the children with. We touched briefly on the wives last time, but we're going to touch on that today. And then we're going to talk a little bit about the Horites as we continue this journey through the unspoken addendum. And for those of you just tuning in, this particular series is approaching the Bible, looking at the lineages, looking at the geography. And that's a good cue to turn my ringer off. But yeah, we're going to be looking at the genealogies all through this. So if you've missed any of the previous episodes in this series, you should go back and watch them before leaving a comment. So yeah, now before we get to that, today's episode is brought to you by Undeniable, full color evidence of Black Israelites in the Bible. As you guys can see, it has 1,250 ratings. Shout out to everybody leaving ratings. Rated 4.8 out of 5 stars. 86% 5-star reviews, 9% 4-star reviews. So if you guys have not checked out this book yet, please do so. It puts an end to a lot of the arguing, people saying we're taking stuff out of context, misreading it, and everything else. It's kind of hard to argue with the artwork. And, you know, people want to say that, you know, there's no evidence or, you know, whatever they want to say. But right here, here's the evidence people drew what they believe the disciples and Christ and others to look like. All right. Now, before we get started, go ahead, get your Bibles ready to Genesis 36. Hopefully, if you're taking notes, you're already prepared. But if you are planning to take notes, now would be a good time to get your pens, pencils, paper, notebook, whatever you're going to use. So before we get started, go ahead and hit that thumbs up button. Make sure you hit the subscribe button if you haven't done so already and you don't want to miss any future episodes. And make sure you hit the notification bell and turn on all notifications. Same thing with your app. Turn on all notifications for the YouTube app as well. Also, if you guys would, I would appreciate if you share this video. And if you don't share the video, at least leave a comment, at least hit the thumbs up. Either way it goes, it helps the algorithm pick up the video and start to share it with more people, the more engagement or activity that happens in the video or with the video. So make sure you do that for me. If you guys want to support, you can go to patreon.com/Dante Fortson. Shout out to all the patrons. They make a lot of this stuff possible. If you want to support anytime during the week, you can go to #BHITB on Cash App. The PayPal link is in the description. And speaking of the description, people have asked me, where do you find the links that I put in the that I put for the references? If you click the description and hit the little drop down button, there are a lot of links in the description. So if you guys are looking for sources and other stuff that I mentioned during videos, make sure you click the drop down box and it should have the links there to those sources, verses, or whatever the case may be. All right. So now let's go ahead and get started with Genesis chapter 36. And we're going to touch on a few things. Some people, hey, you may be disappointed, you may not be disappointed at some of the stuff I'm going to present today. Take it how you want it, but I'm going to present it as is. I've told you guys before, when I started off this journey, the intent was to debunk the claim that Black people in America had any kind of connection to the Israelites of the Bible. But lo and behold, here we are today. I've told you guys before, nobody had a problem with anything I was doing as long as I was researching the genealogy of the Nephilim. But as soon as I started researching the genealogy of people in the Bible and their connection to Israel, then it became a problem. People wanted to say, I'm not Christian, I've walked away from the faith, the body of Christ, all because I'm Black and I say I'm descended from somebody in the Bible. I don't know specifically who, other than Jacob in general. I don't know which of the tribes I'm from. I don't pretend to know. A lot of people want to say Judah, but based on the research that I've seen in the area of West Africa, it was the tribe of Levi, the tribe of Judah, the tribe of Benjamin. I've read sources that said a little bit of Simeon was mixed in. And then we see that there's evidence that they were called the sons of Ephraim. We see, you know, evidence that maybe all 12 tribes were there at some point, if not the whole point. And I don't mean all 12 tribes as a whole. I mean bits and pieces of all 12 tribes were present in West Africa based on the evidence I've uncovered. So I can't just come out and say, hey, I'm Judah or anything like that. But I do trace my lineage to West Africa, which traces to a large part of the tribes of Israel. And if you guys have not seen that evidence, go check out the playlist for the series Addressing the Evidence, parts 1-7. So now we're going to talk about Esau again. We talked about the wives of Esau, the color of Esau. Now we're going to get into the descendants of Esau, but we're going to tie this to some of the wives. And again, we're going to address the Horites today, because a lot of people have a lot of assumptions about the Horites. And that was the reason for me going into that long story about trying to debunk this. I let the evidence go where it goes. I don't care about the preconceived notions. I've said this for years. I change my view to fit the evidence. I don't change the evidence to fit my views. And if it turns out I'm wrong about something, then I'm wrong about something. We all get stuff wrong at sometimes, and we all get stuff right. We'll say the saying is a broken clock is right at least 2 times a day. So yeah, some people are going to be proven wrong today. Well, let's not say proven wrong. Some people may find that what they thought may not be the thing that is true. I'll say it that way, because what I'm about to show today isn't 100% absolute proof of one thing one way or another. However, it is an interesting piece of evidence that forces some of the conversation to shift in a certain direction. And so it's going to be what it is. All right, make sure y'all hit that thumbs up button. You may not want to. Yeah, you can always hit the thumbs down button if you dislike it. But do me a favor and hit the thumbs up button first. And if you dislike what I'm going to say, you can go ahead and hit that thumbs down button later. All right. So now Genesis 36, verse, starting at verse 1. And I'm going to read down to, let me just make sure. I'll read verses 1-8. And then we'll cover those. And then we will continue on and address the rest of everybody else that's gonna come along. But we're gonna read all, let me see how many verses this is, all 43 verses here. But we're gonna do 1-8 first. All right, now these are the generations of Esau, who is Edom. Esau took his wives of the daughters of Canaan, Ada, the daughter of Elon the Hittite, and Aholibamah, the daughter of Anna, the daughter of Zibeon the Hivite, and Bashemeth, Ishmael's daughter, sister of Nebajoth. We covered that. So if you guys haven't got to that far yet in the genealogy, please go back and watch the previous episodes. And Ada bare to Esau Eliphaz, and Bashemeth bare Reuel, and Aholibamah bare Jeush, and Jalam, and Korah. These are the sons of Esau, which were born unto him in the land of Canaan. And Esau took his wives and his sons and his daughters and all the persons of his house and his cattle and all his beasts and all his substance which he had got in the land of Canaan, and went into the country from the face of his brother Jacob, for their riches were more than that they could dwell together, and the land wherein they were strangers could not bear them because of their cattle. Thus dwelt Esau in Mount Seir. Esau is Edom. Now, notice they got all their substance in the land of Canaan. That was verse 6. And Canaan is Hamite territory. So now, we briefly touched on the wives of Esau before. So we're going to look at verses 2-3. Esau took his wives of the daughters of Canaan. So now, for those of you who have believed or have been taught or are teaching that Esau was born the white man, and that because it says he was red or ruddy, that means he's the white man. We've already discovered that's just simply not true. Go watch the previous episodes for that evidence. We know Esau was a reddish brown color, similar to the red heifer. And we did the word comparison. The same word translated as ruddy for Esau is also translated as, I'm sorry, red. Red for the cow. And so you have the same word in Hebrew, which means you cannot apply different color definitions to the same word. There's no evidence that one means white and blushing while the other means reddish brown. The cow and Esau have to be the same color. So you either have to have a white blushing cow or you have to have a reddish brown Esau. And common sense tells you that there are no such thing so far that I've seen. Now, maybe somebody has evidence of a red blushing cow. So now the daughters of Canaan is who he took to wife. These are Hamite women. So even if somebody is of the belief that Esau was the white man when he was born and he was born white, then they have to explain how the white man took Hamite women and then continued to have Caucasian children. It's just what it is. There's no way around it. So he takes his daughter, the wives of the daughters of Canaan, Adah, the daughter of Elon the Hittite. So the Hittites are going to come from Heth, the same sons of Heth that Abraham bought the cave from in order to bury Sarah. And so they are Hamites. Later on down the line, you're going to see, Uriah is a Hittite. Uriah the Hittite is married to Bathsheba because they leave Canaanites in the land. I know a lot of people want to say that, well, Israel wasn't allowed to mix. Well, Israel wasn't exactly obedient. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here talking about this whole mess and punishment from God if Israel did exactly what they were supposed to do. So they left people in the land. They mixed with people. And so later on, the Hittites are going to come up again. Uriah the Hittite, he's married to a Canaanite woman named Bathsheba. And we'll get into that her grandfather was a Gibeonite. And her grandfather played a huge role in David's son doing what he did. And I believe it was out of revenge, because if you look at what Bathsheba's grandfather told David's son to do, it's exactly what David did to Uriah. And again, we'll come back to that. Bathsheba is married to a Hittite named Uriah. And Aholibamah, the daughter of Anna, the daughter of Zibeon, the Hivite. So the Hivites we're going to come back to in a second. Let's see. And Bashemeth, Ishmael's daughter, sister of Nebajoth. And so we'll come back to this, but let's address the Hivites real quick. So the text says that Esau took wives of the daughters of Canaan. Now, two chapters before this, we're going to come back to this because we're going to have to address Jacob and his descendants. But right now we're concentrating on Esau instead of jumping back and forth between Esau and Jacob, which we would have to do if I just went in linear order. So we're going to stick to Esau until we trace down Esau, and then we'll double back to Jacob because Jacob's going to take up the majority of the book when we start to trace Jacob's line. So it's easier to do the side quest first, knock those things out the way, and then come back to the main body of the text, which is going to cover the descendants of Jacob. So now if we go back a couple of chapters, we see that there's a situation with Dinah, where Dinah, who is Jacob's daughter. So Jacob has 13 children. He has the 12 sons and he has a daughter, Dinah. Well, Hamar or Shechem, son of Hamar, is a Hivite, and he rapes Dinah, which is going to lead to his people getting wiped out by two of the sons of Jacob. But we'll come back to that story later. But I just want to read right here. And Dinah, the daughter of Leah, which she bare unto Jacob, went out to see the daughters of the land. And when Shechem, the son of Hamor, the Hivite, prince of the country, saw her, he took her and lay with her and defiled her. And his soul clave unto Dinah, the daughter of Jacob, and he loved the damsel and spake kindly unto the damsel. So this was a Hamite. Shechem was a Hamite. Now, we know this because he is the son of Hamor the Hivite. And if we come back to Genesis 10, we see over here, where are we at? Let's see. These are the sons of Ham right here. And the sons of Ham, Cush, Mizraim, Put, and Canaan. So now when we get down to here, it says, and Canaan begat Sidon, his firstborn, and Heth, which is where the Hittites come from. So it's the daughters of the land of Canaan, and the Jebusite, and the Amorite, and the Girgashite, and the Hivite, and the Arkite, and the Sinite, and the Arvadite, and the Zimmerite, and the Hamathite. And afterwards were the families of the Canaanites spread abroad. So Esau has a Hittite daughter. I'm sorry, a Hittite wife. He has a Hivite wife. And then he has Ishmael's daughter. And Ishmael's daughter, or Ishmael is the son of Abraham and the Hamite Hagar, who was an Egyptian. It says, now, let's keep going. And Adah bare to Esau Eliphaz, and Bashemeth bare Reuel. And Aholibama bare Jeush and Jalem and Korah. These are the sons of Esau, which were born unto him in the land of Canaan. So Esau had Hamite wives, and he had children who were part Hamite, and they lived in Hamite land. Press 1 if that has been emphasized to you in Bible studies before and going to church. Press 2 if it has not been emphasized that Esau had Hamite wives and lived in Hamite territory. So now we're going to keep track of these kids. We're going to, it's 5 kids in total. Eliphaz, the son of Adah, Reuel, the son of Bashemeth, Jeush, Jalem, and Korah, the sons of Aholibama. So now let's go down to verses 6, and we'll read verses 6 through 8 before we move on. And Esau took his wives and his sons and his daughters. So he did have daughters too, just not sons, and all the persons of his house and his cattle and all the beasts and all of his substance, which he had gotten in the land of Canaan, and went into the country from the face of his brother Jacob. For their riches were more than they, that they might dwell together. And the land wherein they were strangers could not bear them because of their cattle. Thus dwelt Esau in Mount Seir, Esau is Edom. So now, notice they are called strangers. That's something that'll come up later over and over again. People will say that when it gets to strangers later on in the book of Exodus and Leviticus, that these strangers are talking about Israelites. And yet we see here that Esau is called a stranger, and Esau is not an Israelite, and he did not, he was not native to the land of Canaan. So this stranger, this word stranger, is not necessarily used of Israelites. And later on, when we look at it in context, Israel had not been separated yet. They had just been freed from Egypt, and he tells them collectively that there was a certain way that they had to treat the strangers. He was not referring to Israelites in context. And so here we see Esau is called a stranger. His family is called strangers when they lived among the Canaanites. And so now Esau is going to dwell in Mount Seir. So now let me ask you this. Let's actually, before I ask that question, let's see. Give me a second here. We'll read down to verse 19. We're going to read verses 9 through 19, and then I'm going to ask a question. And these are the generations of Esau, the father of the Edomites in Mount Seir. These are the names of Esau's sons: Eliphaz, the son of Adah, the wife of Esau; Reuel, the son of Bashemeth, the wife of Esau. And the sons of Eliphaz were Teman, and Omar, Zepho, and Gadam, and Kenaz. And Timnah was concubine to Eliphaz, Esau's son. And she bare to Eliphaz Amalek. These were the sons of Adah, Esau's wife. Some of these names are going to come back up again. Now remember, it talks about the wives, and all of a sudden it mentions this concubine right here. Timnah was concubine to Eliphaz, Esau's son, and she bare to Eliphaz Amalek. Amalek will come back later, the Amalekites, and we'll touch on them when we get there. And these are the sons of Reuel, Nahath and Zerah, Shammah and Mizah. These were the sons of Bashemath, Esau's wife. And these were the sons of Aholibamah, the daughter of Anna, the daughter of Zibeon. This is important. See, the genealogy is important. Esau's wife, and she bare to Esau Jeush and Jalem and Korah. These were dukes of the sons of Esau, and the sons of Eliphaz, the firstborn son of Esau, Duke Teman, Duke Omar, Duke Zepho, Duke Kenaz, Duke Korah, Duke Gadam, and Duke Amalek, the seven of them. These are the dukes that came of Eliphaz in the land of Edom. These were the sons of Adah. And these are the sons of Reuel, Esau's son, Duke Nahath, Duke Zerah, Duke Shammah, Duke Mizah. These are the dukes that came of Reuel in the land of Edom. These are the sons of Bashemath, Esau's wife. And these are the sons of Aholibamah, Esau's wife, Duke Jeush, Duke Jalem, Duke Korah. These were the dukes that came of Aholibamah, the daughter of Anna, Esau's wife. These are the sons of Esau, who was Edom, and these are their dukes. All right, so now we have the dukes of Esau here. I have them all listed out here, and we're going to have Eliphaz, Teman, Omar, Zepho, Gedom, Kenaz, Amalek, who is the son of Timnah the concubine, Reuel, Nahath, Zerah, Shammah, and Mizah. And then let me write here, and we're going to have Jeush, Korah, and Jalem. All right, so now press one. We're gonna let me read this real quick. These are the sons of Seir the Horite. Now I find it interesting that it just jumps from the dukes of Edom to now Seir the Horite. It says these are the sons of Seir the Horite who inhabited the land. Press one if you believe the Horites are descended from Ham. Press two if you believe the Horites are descended from Japheth. Press three if you believe the Horites are descended from Shem. Again, press one if you think they're descended from Ham. Press two if you think they're descended from Japheth. Press three if you think they are descendants of Shem. And I'm going to read something. This is going to be, I'm not going to say the only outside source. I'm not sure why that just happened. But let me go ahead and read this. This is from gotquestions.org. This is some white bottle medicine. For those of you who like the white bottle, and for those of you who don't, you're still going to get the medicine. So, who were the Horites in the Bible? I'm going to read this, and then we're going to take a look and see if the Bible tells us who the Horites are. Because as I was studying through this, I actually noticed something that I had never noticed before. And this study isn't going to be very long because I want to take some time to really just drive this point home and look at what we're dealing with in Scripture because of what some people teach about the Horites. So let's go ahead and read this. All right. So that this is the question asked, who are the Horites in the Bible? And gotquestions.org gave this answer right here. The Horites were an ancient people group who had some dealings with Abraham's family and the Edomites. The little we know of the Horites comes completely from Scripture. The Horites are first mentioned in Genesis 14:16. It says, and the Horites in their hill country of Seir as far as El Paran on the border of the wilderness. They were defeated by the alliance of kings that also defeated the kings of Sodom and Gomorrah, and took Lot and his family captive. The Horites are mentioned as living in Mount Seir at that time. The Horites are next mentioned in Genesis 36, where we are now, where Esau's descendants are listed. Esau settled in the hill country of Seir, which was also the territory of the descendants of Seir the Horite. And it would make sense that if Seir was the leader of the clan, he would name the mountain area where he and his clan settled as Mount Seir. The descendants of Seir are given in some detail in verses 20 through 30. We'll read that in a minute. And they are noted as Horite chieftains or dukes. Deuteronomy 2:12 tells us that Esau's descendants displaced and destroyed the Horites. Deuteronomy 2:22 tells us that the Lord destroyed the Horites so that Esau's descendants could inhabit their territory, also called Edom. Beyond this, there is no more information about the Horites. I beg to differ. They are last mentioned in Deuteronomy 2, except for 1 Chronicles 1, which simply reiterates the information found in the Pentateuch. While Genesis does provide some detailed information about the descendants of Seir the Horite, we know very little about the larger group of Horites, or even if there was a larger group. The etymology of the term Horite may have to do with those who dwell in a cave or hole, aka cavemen. And I've touched on this before, very briefly, about the Horites being cavemen. They lived in the mountains, and we'll see in a second that their name refers to caves. They were cavemen. Now, whether or not they were the modern ideal of what we think of when we think of cavemen, that's another story. But they were associated with living in caves and holes. It is possible that the Horites were cave dwellers, or that Seir himself was a cave dweller, so that the name Seir the Horite simply means Seir the cave dweller. If this is true, then Seir may have been the first of the line, and as his family clan grew, the description eventually took the force of a proper noun, much the same way that last names developed in English usage during the Middle Ages. If you don't know anything about how last names developed, I would encourage you to check that out. The fact that the Horites are mentioned in scripture with no introduction or explanation would indicate that the original hearers and readers of Genesis were familiar with them and the location of Mount Seir. There are many things in scripture that we wonder about because we are separated by so many years. For the original audience, the accounts of the Horites would have been rather recent history and required no further information or explanation. So now, they do have this suggested for further study. It says the Popular Handbook of Archaeology and the Bible by Geisler and Holden. More insights from your Bible study. Get started with Logos Bible software for free. Anyway, we'll come back to that. Now, notice that right here, it says, while Genesis does provide some detailed information about the descendants of Seir, the Horite, we know very little about the larger group of Horites, or even if there was a larger group. And I think that's important to point out, because based on what I found so far, I believe that it is possible that the Horites were a clan that came from a much larger body of people, or a larger clan, sort of how Abraham is a Hebrew and Abraham had a bunch of sons. But when you get down to Jacob, who is Israel, the Israelites are a subcategory of Hebrews, because if Abraham's a Hebrew, then everybody who comes from Abraham is a Hebrew, and everybody who comes from them are Hebrews. And so you will find Hebrews in the Bible that are not Israelites, but all Israelites are Hebrews. Press 1 if it makes sense. Press 2 if it doesn't make sense. All Israelites are Hebrews, but not all Hebrews are Israelites. So it would be proper to say Hebrew Israelite, because you're naming the nationality as a whole, and you're naming their subgroup specifically. It's just like saying you're an American and then putting your last name. Yeah, you're from the continent of America. And people, again, we're talking modern terms. We're not talking about actual accurate geographical or lineage information. So while people will say they are Americans, they will still identify as their smaller family name. And that would go for anybody too. If you're Nigerian and then you identify as your smaller clan or family name. And so I believe that's what the situation we have here with the Horites. So let's go back to Genesis 36 and we're going to continue reading the descendants of the Horites. And I believe that there is a clue stuck in here, which is why we are given so much details on the Horites. I believe it's so that we know where they come from. All right. So it says, these are the sons of Seir the Horite who inhabited the land, Lotan and Shobal and Zibeon and Anna and Dishon and Ezer and Dishon or Dishan. These are the dukes of the Horites, the children of Seir in the land of Edom. And the children of Lotan were Hori and Hemam, and Lotan's sister was Timnah. Now, let's go back just a little bit because we don't want to skip anything. So Lotan's sister was Timnah. And if we come back up here, where are we at? Let me make sure I got the right section. All right. And I just want to make sure I grab the right one before we move on. I don't want to go too fast. Right here. And Timnah was the concubine to Eliphaz, Esau's son. So we see Timnah mentioned in verse 12. And now that we are down here to the Horites, we see that Lotan's sister was Timnah. And the children of Shobal were these, Alvin and Manahath and Ebal and Shepho and Onam. And these are the children of Zibeon, both Aja and Anna. This was that Anna that found the mules in the wilderness as he fed the asses of Zibeon, his father. And the children of Anna were these, Dishon and Aholibamah, the daughter of Anna. Who? Dishon and Aholibamah, the daughter of Anna. So now we're going to pause right here. I think this is a good place to pause real quick. So we have the children of Anna were these. Remember, we're talking about the Horites, Dishon and Aholibamah, the daughter of Anna. But wait, I thought Aholibamah was married to Esau, and Esau took his wives of the Canaanites, and the Canaanites were Hamites. So now we have someone mentioned in the genealogy of the Horites, who is also referred to earlier as a Hivite. If we go back up, so right here, Aholibamah, the daughter of Anna. Let's make sure we're talking about the same person. So in verse 25, Aholibamah is the daughter of Anna. And the wives of Esau, we see the concubine. Let me see. I'm going to go back up more. Right here, Esau took his wives of the daughters of Canaan, Adah, the daughter of Elon the Hittite, and Aholibamah, the daughter of Anna, so it seems like the same person, the daughter of Zibeon the Hivite. So Anna is the daughter of Zibeon the Hivite. So if Zibeon is a Hivite and the Hivites are Hamites, and as I said before, I think the Horites may be a smaller or subset of a bigger group. It would seem that the bigger group would be the Hivites, and the smaller group from the Hivites would be the Horites. And so, based on that alone, I would say that it is very likely that the Horites were descendants of Ham and not descendants of Japheth or Shem. And I know some people like to teach that the Horites were a specific race, or really the white race, because they are cave dwellers or cavemen. And before we finish reading the genealogy, I want to show you guys real quick where that comes from, why they refer to them as cave dwellers over here on gotquestions.org. And the reason I showed that is because people are quick to say that Israelites are racist for saying these sort of things, but gotquestions.org is not an Israelite website. It is a white Christian website, and they also are calling these people cave dwellers. And so if you come over to Genesis 36:20 in the Strong's, you can go to BibleHub.com, click interlinear, and it will bring you over here, and you can click this word for Horite, 2752. And I pulled it up since my internet is kind of spotty. 2752, right here. Kori, inhabitant of Edom, also the name of an Edomite, also the name of a Simeonite. And we get right here. Edom, also the name of an Edomite, also the name of a Simeonite, from the same as Kor, right here. Translation, Hori, Horite, Horites. And if we, let me close down this. If we come down here, we will see in the Strong's exhaustive from Kor or Chor, cave dweller or troglodyte, a Horite or aboriginal Idumean, Horims or Horites. So you will see them mentioned as the Horims, the Horites, and they are called cave dwellers or troglodyte. Now let's look up exactly what a troglodyte was believed to be. Now, if we come over to troglodyte, right here, it says, especially in prehistoric times, a person who lived in a cave, a hermit, a person who is regarded as being deliberately ignorant or old fashioned. So we're not going to go with the old fashioned definition. Let's see, translations and more definitions. Late 15th century via Latin from Greek troglodytes, alteration of the name of an Ethiopian people influenced by trogl hole. So if they're an Ethiopian people, and we accept that Ethiopians for the majority are from Ham, because not all Ethiopians are Beta Israel, if we accept that they are Ethiopians, then it would tie into what I was saying about them potentially being Hamites. And again, this again is not solid proof, but so far it looks like the Bible adds up. And then we see here this reference to Ethiopian people. Do troglodytes still exist? Many of the troglodytes are still in use today, either by residents looking for a simpler way of life, or those making and maturing wine. If you're looking for a place nearby to sleep, well, that's probably going to refer to these. It looks like a cave-like dwelling. I'm not sure. I had to do more research on that. Now, if you click that troglodyte thing over there on the right-hand side, once you look this up, we're going to pull up some pictures in a second. Definition of troglodyte, a member of any of various peoples as in antiquity who lived or reputed to live chiefly in caves, a person characterized by reclusive habits or outmoded or reactionary attitudes. This is from Merriam-Webster. So the troglodytes were cave dwellers. So that is the literal definition of a Horite. They are cave dwellers. And if you look at the images of troglodytes, you see stuff like this. Now, this movie is from Attack of the Titans. Attack of the Titans. Or was it Clash of the Titans? I think it's Clash of the Titans. Right here. This is a troglodyte, a cave dweller. Notice the skin color even in Attack of the Titans. And some people thought, you know, hey, this is a racist depiction. It's a more of a mythological depiction, but if they were Hamites, they would have indeed had darker skin. And you'll see other ones. They're depicted as, you know, various kinds of monsters that dwell in caves and all kind of different legends. So when you hear Israelites referring to certain people as cave dwellers, they may, of course, have mean intent behind it, but it's not inaccurate. It's actually very accurate when they are referring to certain people as cave dwellers. Now, they might be referring to the wrong people as cave dwellers. They may be inaccurate in that aspect, But as we can see, cave dweller or troglodyte, this is from BibleHub.com. This is not an Israelite website. Cave dweller is a word that we saw come up in the Merriam dictionary, and we see it come up in the Strong's. And so these troglodytes were very likely Hamite cave dwellers that were a subset of the Hivites. So hopefully that makes sense. And we'll click Chor real quick just to look over there. Chor means hole, or core means hole, holes, opening, sockets, layers. Let's come down here. Strong's exhaustive, cavity, socket, den, cave, hole. All right. So now hopefully we're all on the same page. So the next time you hear somebody called a cave dweller or a troglodyte, it may be used, some people may be using it as a racial slur, so to speak, but it is also literally the accurate definition of what it is if they refer to somebody as a Horite. And again, the evidence so far points to them being Hamites, and even outside of the Bible, they're linked to the Ethiopians who are Hamites. So let me pick up at verse 26, and we're going to read the rest of these. And these are the children of Dishon, Hemdan, and Eshban, and Ithran, and Charan. The children of Ezer are these, Bilhan, and Zavan, and Akan, or Akan. The children of Dishan are these, Uz, and Aran. These are the dukes that came of the Horites, Duke Lotan, Duke Shobal, Duke Zibion, Duke Anna, Duke Dishan, Duke Ezer, Duke Dishan. These are the dukes that came of Hori among their dukes in the land of Seir. So there is somebody named Hori in the land of Seir. And some people believe that the term Horite or Horim means those of Hori, and they are descendants of Hori. And you will notice that sometimes down the line, there will be a son or grandson or great-grandson that is named after an earlier family member of the tribe. And that occurs often throughout the Bible. So it's important not to get those names mixed up when we're going and looking at the descendancy of people in scripture. Verse 31. And these are the kings that reigned in the land of Edom before there reigned any king over the children of Israel. So Esau had kings first. The Horites had kings first, or dukes first, before Israel is going to get their king when we get to Saul, which is way after the Exodus. Now, this is important because remember, God appeared to Abraham, he appeared to Isaac, and he appeared to Jacob. And God led Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob until we get to the point of the Exodus where it seems like God is nowhere to be found, but then he hears the children of Israel cry out after their slavery, and then he comes back and delivers them. Up until the point that they select Saul, the Most High is the leader of Israel. The Most High is not leading Esau. He's not leading the Horites. He's not leading these other nations in a personal manner like we're going to see him do when Israel is taken out of Egypt, or even prior to them going to Egypt. All right. And Bela, the son of Beor, reigned in Edom, and the name of his city was Dinabah. And Bela died, and Jobab, the son of Zerah of Bozrah, reigned in his stead. And Jobab died, and Husham of the land of Temani reigned in his stead. And Husham died, and Hadad, the son of Bedad, who smote Midian in the field of Moab, reigned in his stead, and the name of his city was Avith. So here's a question. It says he smote Midian in the field of Moab. Well, let's look at something real quick. Now, if we come over to Genesis 25, we will see that Midian is one of Abraham's sons. So now this could only be taken one of two ways. It's, or I guess one of three ways. Either Bedad smote Midian, Abraham's son, or he smote the city or establishment of Midian, or It's talking about a completely different Midian that has nothing to do with Abraham. But to me, it doesn't seem to make sense that they would throw a different Midian in here that has nothing to do with Abraham. And also, we'll see that this happens 11 chapters later. It doesn't necessarily give us a full context of time, but it happens 11 chapters later in the context of chronology of the Bible. And so it is very likely that it is talking about Abraham's son at some point got killed by Bedad, who was a Horite. So again, I could be wrong, and if you guys have evidence that I am wrong, please share it with me. But if we come over here to Genesis 25, we'll see. Then again, Abraham took a wife, and her name was Keturah. This is Abraham's third woman that he's having children with. He had Sarah, and he had his children, Isaac, and well, he had Isaac with Sarah, and then he had Hagar, with whom he had Ishmael. That's two kids right there. And so now he takes a wife, Keturah, after Sarah dies. And she bare him Zimran, and Jokshan, and Medan, and Midian, and Ishbak, and Shua. Let me read those again. Zimran, Jokshan, Medan, Midian, Ishbak, and Shua. So he had six children with Keturah. He had one with Hagar, one with Sarah. Abraham had a total of eight children. We've gone over this before. Hopefully you guys remember this. And right here it tells us Jokshan begat Sheba and Dedan, and the sons of Dedan were Ashurim and Letushim and Leomim, and the sons of Midian, Ephah and Epher and Hanok and Abida and Eldah. All these were the children of Keturah. So Midian did have children. And so it is possible that the Midian being mentioned here in Genesis 36, who was smote by Bedad the Horite, it's possible that he killed Abraham's son in the field of Moab. Why would he be in the field of Moab? Because remember, the Moabites are Israel's, let's see, would it be cousins? So Abraham's nephew is Lot. And Lot is the father of the Moabites. So I believe that the Moabites are Israel's cousins. And I think technically second cousins, if I'm not mistaken. I'm not sure how the first, second cousin thing works completely. But I know if your father or mother's brother or sister have kids, that's your cousins. And I guess their kids would be your second cousins. So the Moabites are the second cousins of the Israelites. So... again, Abraham and Lot are connected, so it may explain why Abraham's son Midian would have been around the Moabites, who would be his second cousins. And to me, it all ties together. So it's very likely talking about Bedad killing Abraham's son Midian in the field of Moab. All right, and I think that's it for... this. I just want to make sure I don't skip anything. So later on, the Midianites are going to come back into play, because when we get to the book of Exodus and Moses flees because he kills the Egyptian, he's going to flee to Midian, not the person, but to the town or city or country. And then he is going to take a wife named Zipporah. Zipporah is not the same woman that is mentioned as the Cushite wife. Remember, this is important that we understand these genealogies as we go through the Bible. Zipporah is a Hebrew because she comes from Abraham's lineage, and Abraham is called a Hebrew. And so Abraham has Midian, who was a Hebrew, and his descendants would be Hebrew. So while Moses took a Hebrew wife, she was not necessarily an Israelite wife, but she does descend from Abraham. Later on, Moses is going to take a Cushite wife, and the Cushites descend from Ham. This is how we know that Moses had more than one wife. And whether people like to admit it or not, it's exactly what it is. Two different women from two different lineages are mentioned, a Midianite and a Cushite. So Moses had more than one wife. And I bring that up because a lot of people are confused. They say they say it's a contradiction. They say Moses had she's called a Midianite. Zipporah is called a Midianite here. And some people believe that she's called a Cushite elsewhere. No, that's not what's going on. Moses had a Cushite wife, and Moses had a Midianite wife. The Cushite wife is not named in Scripture, but her lineage is named. And so, based on what we have learned about the lineages, there's no way possible that Zipporah could have been both Midianite and Cushite, because they come from two different lineages. Zipporah is descended from Shem, and the Cushite wife was descended from Ham. All right, so now, let's continue. And Husham died, and Hadad, the son of Bedad, who smote Midian in the field of Moab, reigned in his stead, and the name of his city was Avith. And Hadad died, and Samla of Masrekah reigned in his stead. And Samla died, and Saul of Rehoboth by the river reigned in his stead. And Saul died, and Baal-Hanan, the son of Achbor, reigned in his stead. So now, what we're seeing is that we're seeing a lot of the Edomites have Hebrew-sounding names. Why is that? Because Jacob and Esau were brothers. They had the same father. They all were Hebrews. Esau was a Hebrew, as we've gone over before. Jacob was a Hebrew, and the descendants of Jacob were Israelites, just like the descendants of Esau were the Edomites. The Edomites are Hebrews. The Israelites are Hebrews, which brings us to the mention of DNA. If Jacob and Esau were twin brothers, and I covered this before briefly, they would have some DNA in common if they weren't identical, 50 to 75%, depending. Go check that out if you guys don't remember that or did not see that episode. I'm not going to try to freestyle all the terminology here because I'm not the DNA guy. Please don't hit me up asking me about DNA. I read from a paper in the previous episode, and that's all I did was read from, you know, studies that have already been out from people who are much smarter than me in the area of DNA. So between 50 and 75% the same DNA, which should make us question whether or not certain people are Esau versus Israel. And we'll get deeper into that and what I mean as we continue on throughout the rest of the studies in this series. But I believe that some people who are believed to be Israel may really be Esau, which is why I don't have the belief that Esau is all the white man or all the white men are Esau. I don't immediately just designate somebody white as Esau, because as we're seeing here, people can argue all they want to, but what we're seeing in Scripture is that Esau had children with Hamite women. And what you would have to prove is that every single one of Esau's sons eventually mixed with Europeans and got whited out. And we're going to come back to that as we move further into the study. We're gonna see where some of the sons went. Everybody isn't accounted for because the Bible doesn't focus on Esau. It focuses on Israel. But let's keep going. I don't want to get sidetracked. And Baal-Hanan, the son of Achbor, died. And it sounds very much like Akbar, which is an Arab name. And I'm not sure if that's even technically correct, if it's considered an Arab name. But for the sake of this, we'll say Arab or Arabic name. If somebody has something more specific on how those names are classified, please share. And Hadar reigned in his stead, and the name of his city was Pau. And his wife's name was Mehetabel, the daughter of Matred, the daughter of Mezahab. And these are the names of the dukes that came of Esau according to their families, after their places, by their names: Duke Timna, Duke Alva, Duke Jetheth, Duke Aholibama, Duke Ella, Duke Penan. And this is what I said before, people will down the line be named after somebody else: Duke Kenaz, Duke Teman, Duke Mibzar, Duke Magdiel, Duke Iram. These be the dukes of Edom according to their habitations in the land of their possessions. He is Esau, the father of the Edomites. All right, so now let's look at a map real quick. All right, so this is the reason that I dropped those Ultimate Bible Companion, so you can see bigger pictures. Because right now what we're looking at is the sliver known as modern day Israel, that general area, and this is borderline on Africa. But as you can see, you have Samaria up here, you have Judea here, you have Idumea down here. And I think it's interesting that they do that on purpose. They seem to cut off these maps so that you can't understand that they are right here by Africa. For those that don't understand what I'm saying, let me see if I can find an Idumea world map to get a bigger view, so you can let me see. Here we go. Here's a bigger view. All right. It's hard to zoom in on this to really give you an idea. But what we're going to have is roughly in this area, you're going to have Idumea, which is where Edom lived. I'm trying to see if we can find a better representation here. Let me see. Here we go. Kingdom of Edom right here. This one's a better representation, but you still can't see the full map. But many of y'all realize exactly where we're talking about. We're talking about this area right here. This is the Sinai Peninsula, and this is Africa. Okay, here we go. Right here, Edom. I didn't even notice that. Edom right here. So you have Edom. You have Amalek, who is an Edomite. We'll come back to Amalek. But Amalek is an Edomite, and so you have them right here, and you have the land of Canaan right here. So between, now this is if we accept the modern geography. I know some of y'all believe that Israel is really in Africa. This is the current sliver of Israel, and we know that we've gone over this before. God promised from the Nile all the way over to the Euphrates, so it's a big chunk of Africa, the Sinai Peninsula, and a bunch of the Arabian Peninsula, if not all of it. But Edom and Amalek, they are closer to Africa than Israel is, based on this sliver right here. So they are closer to Africa. And I'm going to show you guys an interesting picture that goes along with what we've been talking about them being cave dwellers. And for those of you who are, if you're familiar with Petra, press 1. If you're not familiar with Petra, press 2. One more time. If you're familiar with Petra, press 1. If you're not familiar with Petra, press 2. And we're going to read just a little bit about Petra since we are on the subject. All right, here we go. This is from brown.edu. We'll come back to that in a second. It says, according to tradition, in circa 1200 BCE, the Petra area, but not necessarily the site itself, was populated by Edomites, and the area was known as Edom or Red. Before the Israelite incursions, the Edomites controlled the trade routes from Arabia in the south to Damascus in the north. And again, this is by brown.edu. So let's look at some of the images real quick, and then we'll read the Brown entry. And what do we know? They were cave dwellers. This is what we learned. They were cave dwellers. And so you will see Petra here is all carved into the rocks. So the idea of a caveman or the rock dwellers or the cave dwellers may not be as primitive as we think of when we think of cavemen. And I'll pull up a picture of a caveman, but it seems like they were more sophisticated. If, and it says not necessarily, they didn't necessarily live here. That's what it says, but it doesn't mean they didn't live here. But if they did live here, it would mean that these cavemen were a lot more advanced and a lot more sophisticated than we are often taught. But see, that would make sense in the grand scheme of things if they were Hamites, because we understand that if we read through history and we read through some of the racist ideologies that are surrounding history, they did not believe that black people could build civilizations. And so they taught that they were stupid and uneducated and capable, and we were running around Africa with bones in our noses and swinging from trees, and they lumped all black people together. When I say black people, I'm talking about Hamites and Shemites of darker hue. You guys know exactly what I mean when I say black people. You know I'm not talking about the crayon in the crayon box. And if you have not figured that out by now, you should probably go back and learn how language works. If you think somebody's referring to an actual literal black crayon color when they say black. So I'm just showing you guys some of these cave dwellings that are built into the sides of the mountains. And yeah, so the idea of a caveman or a cave dweller, again, may have been more advanced than what we think of. So let's type in caveman and see what comes up. And we're gonna read the brown thing. So, oh wow, the commercial. You guys remember these commercials? So easy, a caveman could do it. I think there was a Geico before they got the lizard. But yeah, this is what we tend to think of when we think of cavemen. We tend to think of primitive cavemen. We tend to think of a man walking around with a club and batting women over the head and dragging them back to the cave. This is what we tend to think of. And yet, what we see from Petra, let me go back, is much more advanced than that. There we go. Yeah, much more advanced than what we've been told. So now let's go to Brown and let's read a little bit about Petra. I was going to read the Wikipedia entry, but it's not necessary. I'm just going to read the brown.edu, but I wanted you guys to see a bigger picture of this, of Petra. Al-Khazneh, Petra Jordan. I told you guys how to look this stuff up. You guys can, see who put these up and all that stuff. Let me see. Let me close that down. Oh, wait. There's more pictures. Let's see. So Petra looks like, and all up in here, you see the caves. And I just want to show you guys stuff. Press 1 if you guys have seen this stuff before. Press 2 if you've never seen this stuff before. This is why I think it's important to really, really go through a lot of this history and archaeology and really start pulling this stuff out. Right here, you got all these caves up in here. Now, I'm not saying that people lived in these. I'll have to do much more research on the area to determine if people actually lived in these, but it looks like they did something there. I don't know what they were doing. They stored stuff there, or maybe they lived there. I don't know. But this is what we see in history. All right, let's go to Brown. Right here it says Petra, from the Latin word petre, meaning rock. Sounds familiar. Peter's name, upon this rock shall I build my church? All right. Petra lies in a great rift valley west of Wadi Araba in Jordan, about 80 kilometers south of the Dead Sea. It came into prominence in the late 1st century BC through the process of the spice trade. The city was the principal city of ancient Nabatea and was famous above all for two things: its trade and its hydraulic engineering systems. It was locally autonomous until the reign of Trajan, but it flourished under Roman rule. The town grew up around its colonnaded street in the 1st century CE or AD, and by the mid-first century had witnessed rapid urbanization. Following the flow of the Wadi Musa, the city center was laid out on either sides of the colonnaded street on an elongated plan between the theater in the east and the Qasr al-Bint in the west. The quarries were probably opened in this period and were followed virtually continuously building virtually continuous building through the 1st and 2nd centuries AD. So from 0 to 200 AD, according to tradition. We just read this in CA BCE, the Petra area, but not necessarily the site itself, was populated by Edomites, and the area was known as Edom, red. Before the Israelite incursions, the Edomites controlled the trade routes from Arabia in the south to Damascus in the north. Little is known about the Edomites at Petra itself, but as a people, they were known for their wisdom, their writing, their textile industry, the excellence and fineness of their ceramics, and their skilled metalworking. The next chapter of the history belongs to the Persian period. And it's, we're just going to read this last paragraph. We'll just read this last paragraph here. Belongs to the Persian period. And it is posited that during this time that the Nabataeans migrated into Edom, forcing the Edomites to move into southern Palestine. But little is known about Petra proper until about 312 BC, by which time the Nabataeans, one of the many Arab tribes, occupied it and made it the capital of their kingdom. At this time, during the Hellenistic rule of the Seleucids and later the Ptolemies, the whole area flourished with increased trade and the establishment of new towns such as Philadelphia, Rabbath Ammon, modern Ammon, and Gerasa, modern Jerash. Infighting between the Seleucids and Ptolemies allowed the Nabataeans to gain control over the caravan routes between Arabia and Syria, although there were struggles between the Jewish Maccabeans and the Seleucid overlords, the Nabataeans' trade continued. All these words. I'm not going to read all of this. You guys can read all of this history of Petra, but just understand what is in the area. We see giant structures that look like caves around a people that are referred to as cave dwellers or troglodytes. So now, give me a second here. All right, so now that you understand who the descendants of Edom, Esau are, and hopefully you got a good understanding of the Horites, the area, the cave dweller reference, all of that. So now it should give you some insight into some things that happen in the Bible. We're just going to briefly pinpoint a couple things. I'm not going to get too deep into this because we'll come back to them as we study and continue this series. And then I'm going to wrap up this video. So in Exodus chapter 17, verses 1 through 7, we have Moses and the water from the rock. And you guys know he hit the rock and he wasn't supposed to hit the rock. But then we have Amalek. We have a mention of Amalek. This is actually the first time Amalek as a nation is mentioned. And so we have to look at that, because outside of his brief mention in Genesis chapter 36 as being a descendant of Esau with Timnah the concubine, well, not Esau himself, but one of Esau's sons with Timnah the concubine, Amalek isn't mentioned again until the book of Exodus. It says, "And then came Amalek and fought with Israel and Rephidim. And Moses said unto Joshua, choose us out men and go out, fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in mine hand. So Joshua did as Moses had said to him and fought with Amalek. And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. And it came to pass when Moses held up his hand that Israel prevailed. And when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed." So for those that didn't know that they were fighting with Edomites when this whole thing took place, you guys will see some of the you guys will see the story. "And it came to pass when Moses held up his hand that Israel prevailed. And when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands were heavy, and they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat thereon. And Aaron and Hur stayed up his hands, the one on the one side and the other on the other side, and his hands were steady until the going down of the sun." Teamwork makes the dream work. Moses couldn't keep his hands up while they were fighting the Edomites. "And when his hands would go down, the Amalekites or Amalek would win. And then when they would go up, the Israelites would win. When they go down, the Amalekites would win. And Joshua discomfited Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword." So Joshua kills one of the descendants of Esau. I believe Esau's grandson, Amalek. And we'll see that all the Amalekites are not going to die. "And the Lord said unto Moses, write this for a memorial in a book and rehearse it in the ears of Joshua. For I will utterly put out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven. And Moses built an altar and called the name of it Jehovah Nissi. For he said, because the Lord hath sworn that the Lord will have war with Amalek from generation to generation. Jacob have I loved, Esau have I hated." And now we're seeing that Amalek, Esau's grandson, the Lord has declared war on him from generation to generation. We see Amalek mentioned again in the book of Numbers, right here. "Out of Jacob shall come he that shall have dominion, and shall destroy him that remaineth of the city. And when he looked on Amalek, he took up this parable and said, Amalek was the first of the nations, but his latter end shall be that he perish forever." He was the first of the nations. It's quite interesting because remember, we see in Genesis, we see Amalek mentioned by chapter 36 in the first book of the Bible. But yeah, we'll keep going. We'll come back to a lot of this stuff. And he looked on the Kenites and took up a parable and said, strong is thy dwelling place, and thou puttest thy nest in a rock. Nevertheless, the Kenites shall be wasted until Asher shall carry thee away captive. We'll come back to all this stuff. And we're going to definitely get down to this part right here. And he took up this parable and said, alas, who shall live when God doeth this? And the ships shall come from the coast of Kittim, or Chittim, some of y'all like to say, and shall afflict Asher and shall afflict Eber, and he also shall perish forever. And we're gonna see Kittim come up again. We're gonna see Zepho, the Edomites, Rome. We're gonna get into the British Empire and everything else that is going to eventually stir up from these names mentioned. And Balaam rose up and went and returned to his place, and Balak also went his way. We see again in 1 Samuel with Agag, when Saul does not kill Agag right here. It says, and the Lord sent thee on a journey. We're right here. Let's start verse 17. We'll read to verse 20. And Samuel said, when thou wast little in thine own sight, wast thou not made the head of the tribes of Israel? And the Lord anointed thee king over Israel. And the Lord sent thee on a journey and said, go and utterly destroy the sinners, the Amalekites, descendants of Amalek, and fight against them until they be consumed. Wherefore, or why then, didst thou not obey the voice of the Lord, but did fly upon the spoil and did evil in the sight of the Lord? He's talking to Saul. And Saul said unto Samuel, yea, I have obeyed the voice of the Lord and have gone the way which the Lord sent me, and have brought Agag, the king of Amalek, and have utterly destroyed the king of the Amalekites. That's not what God told him to do. He told him not to touch none of the spoil and to kill everybody. It says, but the people took of the spoil. But Saul's king, he's supposed to be king over the people. Now he's blaming the people. Does that sound familiar? This woman that you gave me. Adam tried to blame Eve, and now Saul's trying to blame the people, even though he's the head of the people, just like Adam tried to blame Eve, even though Adam was the head. It says, but the people took of the spoil, sheep and oxen, the chief of the things which should have been utterly destroyed, to sacrifice unto the Lord thy God in Gilgal. And Samuel said, hath the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken or listen than the fat of rams. What happened in the garden? They disobeyed. We're not going to get into the serpent seed stuff here, but people want to push this idea of a serpent seed because they overlook the simple things. They're concerned with what kind of fruit it was in the garden that they ate, and whether or not that fruit was literal fruit. They missed the whole point of the story. Obedience, to obey, is better than sacrifice, and to listen than the fat of rams. God wanted them to listen and obey. And what did Adam and Eve do? They rebelled against the word of the Lord by doing what they wanted to do and not what he told them to do. And if we go on, it says, for rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because thou hast rejected the word of the Lord, he hath also rejected thee from being king. So what happened? Eve and Adam, both of them, rejected what God told them when he says, do not touch that fruit and eat it. They rejected that. And so they were ejected from the Garden of Eden. They had to pay the consequence for disobedience, just like Saul had to pay the consequence for disobedience concerning Agag and the Amalekites and the spoil. And Saul said unto Samuel, I have sinned, for I have transgressed the commandment of the Lord and thy words, because I feared the people and obeyed their voice. So the head obeyed the voice of those he was supposed to be over, and therefore he was removed as the head. He wasn't removed immediately. It says, now therefore, I pray thee, pardon my sin and turn again with me, that I may worship the Lord. And Samuel said unto Saul, I will not return with thee, for thou hast rejected the word of the Lord, and the Lord hath rejected thee from being king over Israel. And Samuel turned about to go away, he laid hold upon the skirt of his mantle and rent it, and it rent or tore. And Samuel said unto him, the Lord hath rent the kingdom of Israel from thee this day, and hath given it to a neighbor of thine that is better than thou. And also the strength of Israel will not lie nor repent, for he is not a man that he should repent. And it's referring to the Most High as the strength of Israel. Then he said, I have sinned, yet honor me now, I pray thee, before the elders of my people and before Israel, and turn again with me that I may worship the Lord thy God. So Samuel turned again after Saul, and Saul worshiped the Lord. Then said Samuel, bring ye hither to me Agag, the king of the Amalekites. And Agag came unto him delicately, and Agag said, surely the bitterness of death is past. So he came humbly, thinking that everything was all good. They took him prisoner and killed his people, and he's now going to be a prisoner. And Samuel said, as thy sword hath made women childless, so shall thy mother be childless among women. And Samuel hewed or cut Agag in pieces before the Lord in Gilgal. And Samuel went to Ramah, and Saul went up to his house in to Gibeah of Saul. And Samuel came no more to see Saul until the day of his death. Nevertheless, Samuel mourned for Saul, and the Lord repented that he had made Saul king over Israel. So obedience is better than sacrifice. Saul lost the kingdom because he didn't do what he was supposed to concerning the Edomite king Agag, who was a descendant of Amalek. And then if we come over here to verse 28, they're going to remind him of this. It says, and the Lord hath done to him as he spake by me, for the Lord hath rent the kingdom out of thine hand and given it to thy neighbor, even to David, because thou obeyedest not the voice of the Lord, nor executest his fierce wrath upon Amalek. Therefore hath the Lord done this thing unto thee this day. So he repeats that. So you guys are going to see that there are some dealings between the descendants of Esau, the Edomites, and Israel throughout the Bible. Press one if you were aware that Amalek was a descendant of Esau when you read that story before. Press two if you weren't. No shame, because everybody's at a different place in their learning. Some people, of course, will know, and some people will not. But press one if you knew that Amalek was a descendant of Esau. Press two if you did not. All right, so we're gonna stop right here so that way we don't run too far ahead of ourselves. Next time, what we're going to do is we're going to pick up with Jacob. We're going to get into the sons of the 12 tribes of Israel. We're going to talk about the goings on with them. Who's killing who? Who had children with who? How many people it was when they finally made it into Egypt? If you know how many people it was when they finally made it into Egypt, drop it in the chat. If you know how many people went into Egypt with Israel, go ahead and put that number in the chat. For those of you who don't know, you don't have to put anything in the chat, or you're free to take a guess. But yeah, next time we're gonna get into the descendants of Jacob, and we're going to hopefully get close to the Exodus, because hopefully most of you are familiar with the tribes of Israel already to a certain degree. But yeah. For those of you who have questions about the Horites, if you have questions about who comes from who, if you have a belief that the Horites come from somewhere else, feel free to drop your comments, but leave sources. If you don't have sources, it doesn't hold weight over on this channel. Some channels may accept it, but if you don't have the sources, it doesn't hold much weight. If you have questions, you don't need sources for questions. Only if you're trying to make a statement and saying, hey, well, the Horites are not Hamites, they are really these people, please drop your source. Do me a favor, make sure you hit the thumbs up. If you have not hit the thumbs up already, make sure you subscribe. If you have not subscribed already, you don't want to miss any future episodes. And you also don't want to miss the Day of the Lord Part 2, which is coming up. If you have not shared this video already, please do so. If you want to support, you can go to patreon.com/DanteFortson. If you want to support anytime during the week, you can do so with Cash App using hashtag BHITB. So, yeah, if you guys enjoyed today's study, please press 1. If you did not enjoy today's study, please press 2. Press 1 if you enjoyed, press 2 if you did not. And with that said, till next time. Oh, one more thing. Undeniable 2 is coming up soon. If you don't have your copy of Undeniable 1, grab it. But Undeniable 2 is coming soon. A few weeks out, but it's coming. So anyway, with that said, till next time, I'm out.